Avenue, Buena Vista, that you consider extending the life. You have to decide how far. We would recommend, based on our analysis, that you are eligible to extend to the fullest amount. You can go all the way to the end of the orange there with your existing project areas. That's a decision that you, as the agency board and the city council, need to make that decision. But we're saying we believe it's eligible for you to do that, and we are recommending, from the standpoint of having those resources to actually finish what you've started in Central City and in Sunset Buena Vista, that you consider going to the full end of the orange. Option two, fiscally merging Central City with Sunset Avenue, Buena Vista. We think that's important from a bonding capacity standpoint. We understand the concerns about how are those funds going to be spent. We think that could be addressed through a policy, but we believe the fiscal merger will provide you with the ability to issue debt in a more flexible way, provide you with more resources. The third option, which is to extend and reinstate eminent domain, that is one that is really a decision that you have to make as a community. I can only say it is a critical tool for redevelopment agencies throughout the state, and it's also very important to property owners that are that need those federal and state tax benefits. But it is a very controversial and challenging subject, and I understand that it requires a lot of community dialogue and input about that. And last, we were asked to look at a number of areas. One of the commenters made the point of focus and prioritization. So these areas right now were what we considered to be kind of those focus priority areas based on what we heard, albeit from a small group of people. It was bigger than the four people that you indicated, but from the people that we've been hearing from, we believe that this is a reasonable area. It is a pretty big area, though. If you look at this on the map, it is going to more than double, most probably add two times about as much area as you have now. So that's something you've got to carefully consider. How big do you want to go, you know, with all of this? But we would recommend that you add some area. No matter what, we would recommend you add some of this, some amount of this, because we think it's important that you consider expanding your reach. So in summary, we are recommending that you consider all of these options. If you do decide you want to go forward with that, then a next key step that the city council does is to select the survey area boundary. So basically, it would be to draw on a map like this. It doesn't have to be what we've outlined, but draw on the map an area that you would want to have designated. That could be done after the formation of an advisory committee that weighs in on this. It could be done in combination with that. You could decide to designate a broader area and then get input. Different communities do it differently, but the survey area is the starting point, and that again is done by the city council. So with that, I'd like to open it up for input and questions.
Okay. All right. We will, any additional question, comments from council? Sergio?
A question. In the merger, has you merged fiscally the redevelopment areas, and your experience, how has that process of the advisory committee worked, where you have residents from different parts of the community with different kinds of interests, and how do they become cohesive, if they ever do, and how do they carry a common interest? Because Chinatown folks might not necessarily be too interested in what happens all the way to the end of Williams, and right, vice versa, another area where there's more commercial. So how does that work, if it does work?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So first, even within a project area, like within Central City, there's Chinatown, which is a small part, versus in the downtown, right? So there's even that within an area. In I'm just going to pick Fremont as an example. It's a community where we've worked a long time. They have had redevelopment advisory committees that were formed separately, for they have four redevelopment project areas, three of which are in neighborhoods. So they have had three separate redevelopment advisory committees. They ultimately merged those committees into one, where the constituents from each of the areas have actually come together and talked about priorities. So it happens in different ways. But to your point, I think what's really important is to have the dialogue either amongst the individuals, even if they're separate committees, have some forum where you can bring those ideas together and have a dialogue to help prioritize.
Just one last question. So when you're using the high rate of crime in areas that are not necessarily blighted in meeting the seven conditions, because you could actually have a beautiful neighborhood with beautiful houses, with good systems, but high crime rate, and vice versa, a poor neighborhood with an old house, but it's a good quality of life, because being, you know, somebody used the word of culture or poverty, which I was a little disturbed by it, because there is no such thing. I mean, you could be poor and happy and be living in a neighborhood that is not bad. So how can you use the high rate of crime in areas that are not necessarily blighted?
So that's a really good question.
The seven conditions?
So you have to show that that there is at least one physical condition and one economic condition. So from those lists, you have to show at least one of each. And you have to show that it's substantial and prevalent, which means it can't just be over here. It has to be throughout the area. So a high crime rate in and of itself is not enough for eligibility. It has to be in combination with some physical condition.
Okay. So when you do, it's just questions?
Yes. Well, questions and comments, so just...
Can I give my comments?
Please.
So I'm very supportive of this. I think I've been talking about it for quite some time. I know staff has been, the community has been talking about it. So I think it would be unfair to say that nothing has been accomplished over the years. And I think people just need to do a little bit more homework, look at what really has happened and how some communities used to be in the dark, because they used to be county, used to be an incorporated area, and they still have some signs and symptoms of being an incorporated area, but a lot of improvements have been made, and I think it's an unfair statement. Unless you don't live in this community, I think it's an unfair statement to say nothing has been done over the years. So that's one thing. The other one, initially I think I have a concern about the common vision. I like that we would have one Salinas, one common vision, one common goal, but I think initially might be that we start with separate committees that eventually move with the goal of forming one committee that has a single vision that is citywide. I would like to see that we go into more areas rather than less areas. And that was my question in regards to the high rate of crime, if that could be applied together with meeting one, figuring out another condition that can meet those areas. Example, the Monterey Park residents, pretty active, been able to change things, but you know, there was some crime there. So can some of those things be applied? Because I think we should go for the most and then be talked down to less if we can't prove that we can do it, but I think that there's enough and should be sufficient evidence that we can meet at least two of those criteria. So rather than to go less, or what we propose is to even go more and look at some of those areas that are really, really have issues and actually meet all seven of them, if not all, if not seven, at least most of them, and they would qualify for this. In general, I think as we're asking the communities buying to this, is that we really develop this vision, and because there is no vision for, I think there's some visions for some project areas, but there's some not so clear or not even there. So I think putting a vision of what the community would like to see, not what this council wants or what the staff want or what some people want, is what is the community, the businesses, the residents that live in this area, what do they want? And based on that vision plan, that a plan that actually, and that's what I call the master planning begins of neighborhoods and residential areas, so then we can apply the monies to that. So encumber those monies to say, if we're gonna have a community center in the middle of let's say Williams, then how much does it cost, and let's start acquiring the land and let's start doing all the different things versus saying, give us some more money and we'll see what we're going to do with it. So I think putting the carriage, the horse before the carriage and all that, I think it makes sense to do that, to actually have that visioning process, to have a vision, to have a plan, and actually begin coming up with projects that the community can be said, this is the money we used last year on a quarterly basis, this is what we did with it, versus, you know, once a year, every 5 years. The other one is, I think it's important if we do the merging, because I do support the merging, fiscal merger, but there should be a definite policy in regards to how those funds are used and how those monies are recouped by each of the project areas. And I would be very supportive of some kind of incentive or some interest that is applied, so then there's an incentive to pay that back to that area versus pay whenever you can. And so the separation of accounts and you know, escrow accounts, whatever that is, whatever that accounting process might be, I think that would be a good idea to do. And the last one, I think that was the last one. That's it. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Sergio. Okay. Jill?
Well, I want to just keep my comments short, but just to say that I think that I would support that we look at all four recommendations. I think they all make a lot of sense. I think it's going to be really critical that we get the information out that we are not raising taxes. This is not about taking homes away. It's not about doing away with neighborhoods, raising taxes on neighbors. That's not what we're doing. It's just simply a difference in the way that taxes are allocated. And that's very important for everybody to understand that, and that it's also a benefit for the schools. When we start benefiting the schools with capital improvement projects, I think that this is something that we should probably all work together on to make sure that this happens. Just a couple of comments, though, that I wanted to make. Expanding the West Market area will be a real benefit for our railroad station. As you are probably aware of, the Caltrain project is on schedule for implementation, and I think that the station area would be a great place. We've talked about it, housing, and that would be a good place to look at some TOD, transit-oriented development, as we're looking at some of those, you know, housing figures that might come in. And then the other comment I wanted to make is I hope that we can, as we move forward, I realize this is just the beginning, the very beginning of the process, but as we move forward, I would like us to look at the area on the map, Calaveras, Yosemite, Mendocino, the county streets that are in District 6. Those are old homes with little bit economically depressed there, but I think more the concern is there's a lack of park space, increasing crime, and the way the houses have been built, they have walls that are right on the street, so we have no place for children to play. And so if we can, I liked what you were saying about your area, the Diamond Heights, looking for being able to bring in some little pocket parks in that area. It's a highly dense in terms of population, so it would obviously be very difficult, but it would be something that I think is that we might want to look at adding, because that's a place, a lot of children and very little place to play, very little amenities for children, especially as the crime rate is beginning to increase there. So I like your four areas that you're looking at us supporting, or that we should, I guess, they extend the time and fiscal limits, the merger, the eminent domain, and adding projects. I think this is a great opportunity for Salinas. I really appreciate what you said about your neighborhood, because I think it really makes it clear to people this is not something that we need to be afraid of. This is not money out of our pockets. In fact, it's the opposite. It's money that we end up getting to keep from Sacramento and get to spend it in our city. So this is a good thing for our city. I really support this, and I'm looking forward to us moving the project along.
Thank you, Jill. Gloria.
Well, this is money that is being put back into the community. So that's great. I am going to support the four options. And I had a question for Alan. Alan, looking at the map, does this include Circle and Sanborn, that corner, where it says Madera on your map?
Circle,
on the new proposed, does it include?
Well, Circle and Sanborn is already in the
in
Sunset
the redevelopment,
Avenue
yeah.
project.
Yeah, so
but it doesn't extend over to Cesar Chavez Park. So that's one area that maybe we can consider expanding to.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes. So going back to the comments that were made, my comment would be is to support that we go back.